This video is the first in a series made by the Northwest Straits Foundation in partnership with other shore-friendly programs across Puget Sound. As more and more people move to this beautiful region, the way we live on and interact with the shoreline is changing. The shore-friendly program is committed to helping landowners protect and maintain their investments while also protecting the fish and wildlife that rely on healthy nearshore habitats to thrive. We hope you enjoy this virtual walk on the beach.
My name is Hugh Shipman. I worked for 30 years with the state of Washington as a coastal geologist all over Puget Sound, from Olympia down in South Sound out to the Olympic Peninsula to places like this up in Blaine near the Canadian border. I'm fascinated by how our beaches form, how they've evolved over time, and how they continue to change today. I'm interested in how the geology of the beaches impacts the people who live on them, the hazards, the implications for development, and I'm interested in how the geology influences the ecology of the beach itself. These are all things we'll talk about in the beach today. We're on the beach at Semiahmoo Park in Blaine, just south of the Canadian border. The beach is characterized by several miles of very high bluffs to the south, broad tidal flats, and a large spit that extends north towards the Canadian border across the mouth of Drayton Harbor. While every beach on Puget Sound is made up of different materials and looks very different, our shorelines also share many characteristics. So no matter where you are in Puget Sound, you'll likely see features on this beach that look very familiar to you. Our whole landscape is something that was basically established by the last ice age. This whole area was completely covered with ice 20,000 years ago, and it shaped the land underneath it. The glacier that extended into Puget Sound was thousands of feet thick, 10 times higher than the highest bluffs we see around Puget Sound, and several times higher than the highest skyscrapers of the Space Needle in downtown Seattle. When the ice melted back, it pretty much left the landscape that we see today. Most of the upland area and the forested area is pretty much as the ice left it, with the exception that many, many generations of trees have now grown on it. Where there have been big changes are near our big river mouths and along our shoreline itself. The big rivers that come out of the Cascades or the Olympics, these rivers have been carrying very large amounts of material from the mountains down to the shore and filling in the sound. Over the last 5,000-6,000 years, waves have been working on the coastline. They've been eroding the shoreline back. And wherever the land is high, you end up with a steep bluff. Bluffs themselves consist of material that was left by the glaciers. Some of it's older than that, but it consists of sand and gravel and boulders. And as that material erodes, that material ends up on the beach itself, where waves can then mix it up, break it apart, and then can move that material along the shoreline. Things like boulders, like the large boulders here in the background, are too large for the waves to move. So when they end up on the beach, they just don't go anywhere. They've been there sitting in pretty much the same position for a long time, but the sand and the gravel is much easier moved by wave action during storms, in particular at high tide when the waves are acting on the beach. And because the waves are often coming from the south in this location, it's moving material along the coastline to the north. It gets to Drayton Harbor, which is the large bay that's sort of out in the distance here, and that material built a spit across the mouth of the bay. The material on the beach could be seen as part of a conveyor belt that's moving material from those eroding bluffs somewhere else. We have a really nice example here of an eroding bluff, very typical of what we see around Puget Sound. The big difference in our bluffs besides their height is some of them are covered in vegetation and some are not. It's a reflection of how recently they slid or they eroded. In this case, we have a stretch that eroded fairly recently, perhaps during a big rainstorm or after a wet winter, and that material slid down to the beach. That may have been very dramatic at the time. The long-term pattern is slow. This doesn't happen very often. It usually doesn't involve a lot of material. So most people's homes, even though it may be a little disconcerting, are not at risk unless the house was built very close to the edge. But the rate may ultimately amount to just, you know, a few inches or a foot a decade or something. But that material slides down the bluff, it ends up on the beach, and the waves go to work on it. The waves separate material out depending on what kind of material there is. It's very common to see gravel high up on the beach here at high tide and sand farther offshore. But what people often don't appreciate is that on a beach like this that looks like it's all gravel, if you actually look carefully, what's underneath is probably more sand than gravel. But the gravel creates a nice even surface across the top, and the sand is hidden underneath. Some of our beaches look like they're all gravel. Some beaches look like they're all sand. Some beaches don't have big boulders like this one. Every beach is different because the bluffs that eroded to form the beach were made up of different material. This bluff is just one short stretch of 2 or 3 miles of high eroding bluffs behind me. Much of this material actually came from much farther away, and it's moving its way to the north, eventually to form some Yamu spit. As waves have been acting on these beaches for a very long time, they develop a really characteristic shape. And that shape and the zones that result from that are very important ecologically as well. If you look at this low tide beach, often a very flat sand flat, like we have offshore here, that is usually underwater during most tides. And because it's underwater, it's wet, it supports vegetation like seagrass or algae. And so we'll often see where there are rocks, we'll see algae growing in the rocks. In some places, you'll see eelgrass basically covering those sand flats. The upper part of the beach from low tide up to a high tide, we often call the beach face. It's made of bigger material, gravel, sand, though the sand's often hidden underneath. But there may be, depending on what storms and tides have occurred recently, sometimes you'll see distinct bands of different size material going up or down the beach. There may be biological activity going on underneath where it still stays moist through a whole tidal cycle. As the beach rises, it levels out up at the top in what we call the berm or the backshore. That's where waves are able to basically push material during big storms up to the top of the beach. It's where the drift logs accumulate. And then behind that, you've got the bluff. The bluff is usually forested. There's going to be vegetation, sometimes collapsing on the beach, sometimes hanging out over the beach. That provides in itself a rich habitat. So even though the beach is basically a geological phenomenon, every one of those zones has unique biology associated with it. That low tide terrace supports seagrasses and shellfish that can dig in the sand. And even the upper part of the beach here, which is fairly regularly worked by waves, it actually is an area where a lot of fish will spawn. So we've got a very complex system lined up in zones in which the geology basically sort of dictates the different biological regimes that we see. And it turns out to be a very rich biological environment. These beaches have been evolving for thousands and thousands of years, ever since the ice left. Humans have been on this landscape for almost that whole time. In the past, it was mainly for fish, shellfish, gathering resources, access to the water. But more recently, we started to build houses in the shoreline, roads, and this starts to affect the beach itself. The most dramatic effect is often in the forested landscape. We cut the trees down for views and for light, and that not only affects the ecology of the coastline, but it can actually increase the likelihood of landslides. It can increase the erosion problem. The erosion itself is a problem to people who live right in the shore. They don't want to lose property. They're nervous about what's going to happen in a big storm. They build bulkheads, they build seawalls. Those may slow the erosion in some areas, but they also cut off the supply of material to the beaches themselves. Our beaches are made up basically of material that eroded from a bluff somewhere. So now that we've been here for a while, we're starting to become part of the beach story ourselves.